Support for In the Frame, Exploring the DIA is provided by Masco Corporation Foundation. Masco is a global manufacturer of home improvement and building products.
Annie Leibovitz must be among the most famous photographers in the world. Most of us are familiar with her image of a naked John Lennon coiled around his wife, Yoko Ono, taken, tragically enough, just hours before he was murdered. Or there's the startling photograph of Whoopi Goldberg in a bath of milk, or a very pregnant Demi Moore on the cover of Vanity Fair. Recently, Annie Leibovitz toured the US, taking photographs of musicians who have been influenced by and shaped the great musical traditions of this country. Blues, rock, country, bluegrass, gospel, hip-hop. But she didn't photograph these individuals where we usually see them, on stage. Instead, she took them to slightly out-of-the-way places, the recording studio, rehearsal rooms, hotel rooms, the countryside, the streets, bars. These photographs now comprise the exhibition Annie Leibovitz, American Music. And in today's episode of In the Frame, we're going to take a closer look at the work of this artist and the individual she depicts.
Annie Leibovitz has had a long career as a celebrated portrait photographer. She was actually born in 1949 in Connecticut. She was the daughter of a military man, Samuel Leibovitz. And she traveled quite a bit throughout the US and to the Philippines and even Japan. But she settled in the late 1960s in San Francisco, where she studied painting and photography at the San Francisco Art Institute. It was there that she began to document the local peace demonstrations and anti-war demonstrations in the city. She was very interested in the culture of San Francisco. And she brought these photographs to Robert Kingsbury, who was then editor and publisher at Rolling Stone magazine. He immediately loved her work and offered her a number of initial photo sessions with people like John Lennon and Grace Slick. This led to a very long career at Rolling Stone, photographing music in particular. For 13 years, Annie Leibovitz worked at Rolling Stone. One of the highlights of that period was a commission to photograph and document the Rolling Stones' 1975 world tour. In the early 80s, Leibovitz really felt she wanted to broaden her access to celebrities, to dancers, to athletes, and she began working for Vanity Fair. And it wasn't until the 1990s that she actually began a series of book projects that led to the American Music Exhibition.
Why these people? It's a very personal, subjective choice. American music is so rich and so varied that you could fill three books of musicians I love and admire. I'm particularly proud of having the chance to honor these great musicians. It seemed like the most natural place to start was really in the Delta. It became the foundation for the rest of the book. Having worked for Rolling Stone magazine for 13 years, from 1970 to 1983, and then, you know, the last 20-odd years I've been working at Vanity Fair and Vogue, I love the idea of going back into where I started and trying to see what a mature eye would yield. It was definitely a labor of love.
In 1999, Annie Leibovitz began shooting for her book project, American Music. She made hundreds of photographs all over the United States. And from these photographic sessions, she pulled about 70 works that are now on view in American Music at the Detroit Institute of Arts. She traveled all throughout the country, beginning in the Delta, in the Mississippi Delta, and she used color and black and white film, as well as a variety of camera formats, including 35mm, medium format, and even large format cameras. The purpose of this was to take pictures often that were behind the scenes, intimate views of the musicians, to create, sort of give the viewer an idea of how music was made backstage in people's homes, and even on family porches. Leibovitz had a long career photographing musicians, knew a great deal about music, and was a very celebrated portrait photographer in her own right, often just as famous as the people she was photographing. So it gave her a very unique, collaborative type of relationship with those individuals that really made for some great intimate and personal pictures. Leibowitz wanted very much to show how music was made, and I think she does this in the exhibition.
Annie Leibowitz started her quest in the Mississippi Delta, a region that includes not only the Delta itself, but stretches all the way up the river to Memphis, Tennessee, and east along the Yazoo River. African Americans have lived and worked in this region for centuries, sometimes under the worst conditions imaginable. And in fact, it's the area that gave birth to the blues. This photograph behind me features Highway 61, near the crossroads where Robert Johnson is said to have sold his soul to the devil for his extraordinary guitar playing abilities.
Leibowitz looked for not only the great blues legends in the Mississippi Delta, but she also looked for the places where the music was made. And she found Po' Monkey's Lounge, one of the last surviving juke joints in the South. She photographed this great old shack in black and white, and it really has a timeless quality to it. It could have been a photograph from the 1930s, and it probably appeared like this in the 1930s. She also photographed great blues legends B.B. King and Arl Burnside. The B.B. King photograph is a really wonderful 35mm snap in the bar, a very intimate picture. Leibowitz is on stage, and you feel like you're right there when you're looking at the photograph. And interestingly, she went to the home of Arl Burnside, and she frequently started out at the homes of the musicians. She wanted to capture them in those off moments, and Burnside is showed with his family playing guitar. Leibowitz got to experience the music right there, and it's a wonderful motif that she repeats throughout the exhibition, showing the older guitarist or the older musician playing with the family and passing down that music from generation to generation.
I went looking for a juke joint on our Delta trip. Really, I was looking for a place where I could photograph dancing. We heard third hand, fourth hand, fifth hand, how to get to this place. But it was located in cotton fields, 2 miles down a gravel road off of Highway 61, and it was closed. I was just pacing outside, walking up and down, looking at it, and it was really quiet. And the longer I looked at it, the more I realized how wonderful it was. And it was a photograph unto itself. And it was an important picture for me because it was done early on in the book, and I realized how important architecture was. This turned out to be William Po' Monkey Seabury's home. And every Thursday night, he turns it into a juke joint.
When people of European ancestry settled here, they brought their musical traditions with them, from the Highland reels of Scotland to the polka of Eastern Europe. The music that developed out of that here, country western music, spread itself from the Appalachians over Texas and through to the West. This kind of music was popularized in the 1920s when a talent spotter called Ralph Peer discovered Jimmy Rogers and the Carter Trio. Also, different regional styles developed: rural honky-tonk, western swing, the pop-oriented Nashville, and an outlaw attitude that blended country with rock.
Leibowitz traveled south not only to photograph the great musicians of the Delta Blues region of the United States, but she also traveled south to Virginia, Texas, and even the Appalachian Mountains to photograph the great country music legends and songwriters of that part of the country. One place she thought was very important was the Carter family porch, and she captured Johnny Cash, the late Johnny Cash, and Roseanne Cash strumming their guitars and singing with the grandchildren standing around the porch. She recognized the importance of the passing of those traditions on from one generation to the next. Was particularly important to roots music that this occurred, or else the music would not have survived for so many generations. But interestingly, in this particular section of the gallery, she shows a number of very formal studies, more studied compositions of people like the late June Carter Cash and Johnny Cash, portraits, a wonderful portrait of Willie Nelson that's really a study in line, texture, composition, and light. It very much reveals the character of those sitters. Another photograph of Emmylou Harris shows Leibowitz's great attention to light during certain times of the day, something that's very important in black and white photography. And she captures Harris, a beautiful singer and sort of an understated country performer, at dusk, right after the rain. It's a beautiful photograph with her face just glowing in that very wonderful late dusk evening light.
I had a great time with Willie Nelson. Met him down at his ranch, Luck Ranch, in Spicewood, Texas. I was so pleased with what the photographs were. I mean, I only shot a few photographs. His face is just a roadmap of his life. And I think of Samson and Delilah, his long hair, and when he shakes his hair, you know, it's something to watch. When I look at this picture, I think of the Indian nickel. I really thought of Emmylou Harris as like this quintessential musician, but a woman with a guitar, and felt like she had done it across the board. Red Dirt Girl had just come out, and as we were working in Nashville, listening to the album a lot, I started thinking about looking for a dirt road. We were pretty lucky because it just rained, and there was this farming area right outside of Nashville, and it was very romantic and beautiful.
And that's a fact. Yeah, we're going to Jackson. Ain't never coming back. Married in a fever, hotter than a pepper sprout. Honey, we've been talking about Jack.
As I said earlier, Annie Leibovitz chose not to show her subjects in public performing. Instead, she chose more private moments, say when they're rehearsing or in the recording studio, or even in hotel rooms or their own homes with their families and friends. Every so often, though, she chooses settings that are tinged with ambiguity, and very occasionally with downright mystery.
In addition to her portraits of individuals from the American roots music tradition, Leibovitz also wanted to photograph contemporary artists who'd been influenced by roots music traditions like jazz, blues, and country music. She captured the more ordinary moments in their lives, or the ordinary moments that informed their music making, like in this photograph of Lucinda Williams captured on a back dirt road next to her pickup truck.
I think of Lucinda Williams as being one of the great songwriters of our time. We actually went to see her and meet her in Nashville and drove up to her house and walked in, and she had just moved in and she was trying so hard to make it a home, but it didn't feel lived in yet. I just thought there was no place for me to photograph her, and I didn't feel like the house reflected her songs. I said, "We're going to meet up with you somewhere else or on the road." And she talked about she was going to be playing at South by Southwest, the music festival in Texas. And I said, "Well, why don't we meet up there?" And we ended up doing it on the road outside of town with a pickup truck that she owns. That's not unusual for me to go somewhere, meet the person, and say, "Let's do it another day."
The final gallery of Annie Leibovitz American Music features musicians who were born in Detroit and musicians who have performed and created music in the city. Their contributions have given Detroit the reputation as a music capital and have influenced popular music, the blues, rock, and rap over the course of 60 years. Most recently, the success of rock band The White Stripes and rapper Eminem prove that artists and performers continue to find inspiration from the urban and working class culture of our city.
I don't know what this picture means. The truth is, there's nothing more to it than Dada. It's just a Dada picture. And that's who the White Stripes are. I just love that this band is a duo, and to see them play music together is like watching a dance or romance. We actually had the Target left over from Cameron Diaz shooting for Vogue. It was just sitting around the studio, and we were trying to think of what to do with it, and we knew we had to photograph the White Stripes. John Lee Hooker was 83 years old when I took this picture. It was actually a couple years before he died. I took some photographs in his house, and he had his Cadillac parked outside. I loved it. It was parked right up against the door. Even though he was living in Northern California, he was still parking his car like on his lawn, pretty much the way they do in the South. We set up a little portable studio in his garage, and most pictures you see of John Lee Hooker, he has his sunglasses on, and I asked him if he would take them off for photography photographs, and he did. And I hear people remark when they look at this picture, they don't realize it's him. Not too many people recognize him without his sunglasses, and I thought it was interesting to see his eyes.
What everybody talking about? In the swing club. I sighed, I dropped in there now. But I got down. I said, yeah, people. They were really having a ball.
Aretha Franklin was photographed on a visit to her home in Detroit. The home was very glamorous, you know, befitting of the Queen of Soul, and it's just a very simple portrait. It could almost feel like a home snapshot, except for that she has a little bit of a look in her face where you can sort of tell who she is. I mean, she's pretty confident, has a little arrogance, but doesn't mind feeling sexy. It's not an on moment. That's what I like about it. Poor Iggy Pop. Every time anyone goes to photograph him, they're asking him to take off his clothes. He came to the door with no shirt on, and he said, I'm not taking my clothes off. And of course, by the end of the shoot, he did have his clothes off. His body's like a roadmap of rock and roll, and I just felt like I wanted to photograph him as if he was under a microscope. You could somewhat take his life from the lines in his face and in his body. Patti Smith and I go way back. I had gone to see her. She had basically retired from music and had gone to live in the suburbs of Detroit, Michigan with her husband, and she had two children. And when I went to see her for this photograph, her husband had just died a year or two earlier. She was still in mourning. I found this out later, but the reason this mattress was in the living room was that after her husband died, she didn't want to go back into her bedroom and sleep in that bed. So she had been sleeping on that mattress in the living room. I felt like she was very fragile, and it was just a very simple portrait in her house. What was great about Beck is went to meet him at his house, and we drove up, and this Lincoln was parked in the driveway. We did the whole shoot. We were in his backyard, and we shot some strange pictures back there. And as I was leaving, I looked at the car again, and I said, is this your car? And he said, yes. And I said, do you spend a lot of time in it? And he says, I'm in it all the time. That's all I do. I live in that car, and that's where I listen to all my music. I said, well, let's do some pictures in here. And we took a couple pictures. We actually talked about doing another kind of picture that was more conceptual. When it came down to it, I went back to this photograph and I said, you know, this is sort of it. We were scheduled to photograph the Roots, and they were coming to the studio. And as I was finishing my research, I realized that they first played all together on street corners in Philadelphia. So I said, wait, don't have them come here. We'll go to Philadelphia. And we went down to Philadelphia and met them there and brought them back out to the streets where they started. What they're most famous for, of course, is that they play hip-hop with real instruments. I can't think of two stranger people to be together. This photograph came from a shooting I was doing with Laurie Anderson at the Coney Island Aquarium. Lou Reed came along, and they were just going out, and I just really took that picture for them. It was really like a snapshot. Here are these two very different people, and Lou Reed is considered, you know, real rock and roller, very hard, and Laurie has a kind of hard edges. And you put both of them together, and they both became like puppy dogs. And they were both obviously very much in love with each other. Preservation Hall is a large room in a building in the French Quarter in New Orleans. The people who bought the building in the 60s had it as an art gallery, and they allowed musicians to rehearse there. And subsequently, the musicians started playing there regularly, and they became known as the Preservation Hall Jazz Band. And I photographed the whole band, and we told them to take a break. And when they walked out, I looked at the room and said, yeah, the room looks pretty great without them. And you can almost hear the music playing, and I thought it was a better picture without the band.
The more I learn about a subject, usually, the harder it is to play favorites. But there are a few pictures in this exhibition that I find particularly moving. One of them is this image of Brian Wilson at the pool of his house in California. Here he is, the greatest surfer musician of them all, standing in his flowered swim suit with his bright blue robe on. And right behind him and coinciding with the flowered swimsuit are those roses, white, popping out there with the beautiful red and yellow flowers in the background. Everything is wonderful, sunny California, except at the very top of the picture, you see a band of gray swirling clouds that coincide with the artist's head and allude to his well-documented problems that he's endured throughout his life and career. Another picture that I like, and maybe it's because I like the artist himself so much, or his music so much, is the one of Tom Waits, where you see him looking rather demented, if not demonic, pounding on the harmonium and surrounded by musical instruments and other noisemakers that he uses to such effect and such delight of those who listen to his music regularly. And then finally, there's this image of A.B. Boogaloo Ames, taken when the musician is at the very end of his life. It's done in these soft golden and brown tones. You see the old musician there with a twinkle in his eye and a wry smile on his face, and his hand resting firmly on the battered keys of an old upright piano that forms the background to the picture.
Brian Wilson is another genius. The early Beach Boys work was extraordinary, and you know, it laid the groundwork for so many other artists. The sky that was there the day we took that picture is sort of a metaphor for Brian Wilson's up and down life. It's more of a state of mind that there's a California dream, and it's not necessarily true. Tom Waits, he's a great musician. He just loves collecting instruments. He was recording in a set of buildings in Northern California. It was amazing to see the number of instruments that they were collaging into the songs. These were old buildings. They weren't like recording studios. They were just old ranch buildings, and he just liked the ambience in that room. It wasn't like it was a recording studio. Boogaloo Ames, who we photographed here in Greenville, Mississippi, at this point, he's in a retirement home, and we photographed him at a piano in the retirement home, but he's a great musician. For example, he toured with Louis Armstrong, and he worked as a band leader in the 40s, and he was also a studio musician, and he returned to the South in the 60s and settled in Greenville. Actually, it's one of his students, Eden Brent, who helped keep him going in his last few years. That's who we met, and she introduced us to him.
I hope you've enjoyed this episode of In the Frame. You can find more about our programs and exhibitions on our website at dia.org. In fact, if you're interested in a particular exhibition, such as the Annie Leibovitz show, it's probably a good idea to check before visiting, because these exhibitions come and go. There's always a high likelihood that there will be some kind of special exhibition on any time you visit the DIA, and of course, there are always extensive selections from our wonderful permanent collections to view at any time. Until next time, this is Graham Beale, your guide to one of America's great art museums, the Detroit Institute of Arts. Thank you.
Support for In the Frame, Exploring the DIA is provided by Masco Corporation Foundation. Masco is a global manufacturer of home improvement and building products.